I'm Timothy West, and this is my wife, Prunella Scales. We might be known as actors.
Basil?
But when we're not treading the boards, it's all hands on deck.
Cast off, please.
Aye, sir. We're canal nuts, and we've been pottering around on them nearly all our married life.
With our two boys, Joe and Sam, we've had some of our best times on the canals.
Whenever we get a break, we dash off to our boat.
But we're both getting on a bit now.
I'm going to need some help.
We are determined to make the most of what we love, whilst we still can.
Pru has a slight condition. It's very mild, but it does mean she has difficulty remembering things.
Oh, Tim! I'm so sorry, I didn't cast you off. Well, it can be a nuisance sometimes, but it doesn't stop me remembering how to open a locked gate or make the skipper a cup of tea.
This time, we're going to take three totally new journeys.
It's as if you're suspended in mid-air.
And repeat our first ever canal trip.
Making the same old mistakes.
Sorry.
What was all that about?
It's a contact sport.
This week, a pilgrimage to the inspiration behind Britain's canals. In the south of France.
Very impressive.
At an astonishing 330 years old, the Canal du Midi was ahead of its time.
And it's not just a feat of engineering, it's also a work of art.
We're on a voyage into the rich history of this canal, a past that we can touch, taste, hear,
and occasionally hit.
Oh, bugger.
I'll be journeying back into my own past, along a route that keeps leading me back to France.
I nearly married a Frenchman at one point. I mean, I'm very glad I didn't.
So am I. But we do have a French branch to our family.
Bienvenue! Whoa.
Yes, for the final stretch, our son Joe and his two boys are joining us.
As we explore the godfather of canals, wending its way towards the Med.
Our voyage begins on the edge of the small winemaking village of Argent-Minervois, where our boat is moored.
Well, there we are.
There she is.
A bit unusual.
Hope we get the weather. There's no covering on deck.
The French like wide canals and wide boats, known as péniches.
Hey, it's massive.
Compared to our own narrow boat, this is positively luxurious.
Wow, I think this is us, darling.
Right.
Okay.
Suitcases stowed, it's time to explore the Canal du Midi.
Built as a shortcut between the Atlantic and the Mediterranean, the Canal du Midi links the Garonne with the Étang du Thaux and runs for 150 miles through the Languedoc region. We'll be sailing along the canal's most picturesque stretch as it meanders its way towards the coast.
For 300 years, this was a working canal filled with barges laden with the region's wine and wheat. Today, most of its vessels carry tourists drawn here by its sheer beauty.
But this canal wouldn't be here at all if it hadn't been for the passion of one man.
Pierre-Paul Riquet, really, I suppose, we should regard as the father of the canal system. He was the builder of this canal, which was to do the very important thing of linking the Mediterranean with the Atlantic.
For centuries, the French had longed for an inland trade route to avoid the pirate-infested Straits of Gibraltar. Finally, in 1667, the 59-year-old salt tax collector, Pierre-Paul Riquet, took on what his contemporaries considered a technically impossible challenge. Using up to 12,000 workers over 14 exhausting years, Riquet completed the Canal du Midi a full 100 years before Britain's canal revolution.
In a country that doesn't always relate very generously to its canal system,
no, quite.
This one really does. I mean, he is He is venerated, he's worshipped.
Heralded as a work of both engineering and artistic genius, in 1996, Riquet's Canal was declared a UNESCO World Heritage Site.
Our first port of call is Riquet's home whilst he was building the canal, Château de Parizade. Then it's onto the old canal staging post of Le Samail.
Tim may be looking forward to immersing himself in the history of canals, but this voyage is leading me back into my own past. Increasingly, my early memories can be clearer and more vivid than the present, like memories of being in France as a young woman.
France has been part of my life for a very long time. I mean, I had a French au pair, and I learnt a lot from her. And then I went over and stayed with her family, and then I went over and I met a lovely Frenchman, and we were very much in love. I very nearly married a Frenchman at that stage. And of course, our younger son is married to a French girl, and we have three half-French grandchildren. So a lot of my life has been in France and about France.
You going to mug me?
Am I going to mug you?
Is that gorgeous or what, eh?
And I believe I can run a decent marathon.
Thank you very much.
Download Veely now.
I'm going to lose my hat. Jolly nearly did.
Even though this is my third time on the French canals, I still haven't got the hang of their boats.
Sorry.
It's all right. That bridge looks as old as the canal. Is it one of the original ones?
It might be. Yeah, but it's certainly very old. Yeah.
Look out this side.
Oh, bugger. Buggeration.
Bad luck. Yeah, it's very dodgy. Very, very dodgy.
It is very tricky to maneuver.
Well, you're
it takes
not used...
quite a long time to respond, and then you over-respond and have to compensate. It just takes a bit of getting used to it, so.
Well, you've got a few days to learn.
Yes, I could be sailing in a straight line by the time you reach the Med.
So we're not far now from Parizade, where the chateau is that Riquet stayed in.
Oh, right.
While he was engineering the canal.
Bad digs, are they?
No, I've stayed in worse. Being at roughly the midpoint along the route of the canal, the Château de Parizade was an ideal base for Riquet. The chateau was owned by the Baron Juglar, and as thanks for the Baron's hospitality, Riquet built him these seven terraces.
Another one?
Yeah.
Right, okay.
Another one.
Wish he'd built a lift.
Antoine is the current owner, and a distant relative of Riquet himself.
Hello. Nice to meet you.
Wonderful to be here. Thank you.
Welcome to the Château de Parizade, home of Riquet. We see?
Please.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Wonderful things.
Antoine is restoring the Parizade, which will open soon as a luxury guest house, and he's intensely proud of his chateau and its heritage.
And there you are discovering the rooms where Riquet lives for 10 years during the end of the construction of the canal.
And of course, look straight out on the canal.
Yeah, Riquet would not have left for 1 second his work, so even when he was sleeping, he was looking after the canal.
Yeah.
I can imagine Riquet standing here of an evening, pondering on how to transform his impossible dream into reality. History was made at this window.
Wonderful view.
Finally, in the room where Riquet worked, the Parizade's most treasured possession, the original 17th century plans, annotated by Riquet himself.
There is the chateau, and down there, Le Canal Royal, which was the name of the canal at this time.
Mm-hmm.
When did it become known as the Canal Royal?
1661, when Louis XIV let Riquet start the canal alone, and when he saw that was going to be a huge masterpiece that should impress humanity at the time, he took it for him. Mm-hmm. He says it was a royal canal.
Yes.
So when exactly did it become the Canal du Midi?
At the revolution.
Yes.
Uh-huh.
Yes. When we killed our king, couldn't be anymore Canal Royal. Has become Canal du Midi at this time.
Ah, oui, d'accord.
After a long day at the canal face, Riquet needed fortification and was partial to Trois Six, a brandy made at the chateau.
So what vintage are we talking about?
1830 vintage.
What?
That's more than one century and a half.
Gosh, a bit privileged.
None of Riquet's 17th century vintage is left, but we are still being offered a rare treat.
Trois Six is 96% proof. 666, they didn't give it the devil's number for nothing.
This one, it is very strong.
Incredibly strong.
Yeah.
I've never tasted anything like it before in my life.
I don't think I can manage it anymore. It's really violent. It's too strong for me. I don't think I've ever said that.
May I propose a toast to Pierre-Paul Riquet?
To Pierre-Paul Riquet.
We spent too much time toasting Riquet this afternoon, and we've fallen behind schedule.
Here we are, sailing, as we often do, into the night. And you can see bats flying overhead.
The trouble with the night is that you can't see where you're going.
Bugger.
At last, the lights of Le Sommeil. And luckily for us, the restaurants are still serving.
We may have only travelled 10 miles today, but in this tranquil spot beside the canal, it seems like we've been transported 100 years back in time.
Our first morning on the Canal du Midi. We're moored in the old canal port of Le Sommeil. And thanks to some noisy neighbours, we awoke early. Back in the canal's heyday, this was a busy place. In 1831, 28,000 passengers visited the port. Today, the focus is still on supplying canal travellers with the necessities of life in the south of France, like fresh bread.
Bonjour, madame.
Bonjour, monsieur.
And sun hats.
Ce beau chapeau rouge.
Ah, petit déjeuner sur le canal. Pour tout le monde.
Put your hat.
Wow.
Yes.
Merci, mon chéri.
Today, we'll pass the villages of Mirepoix and Argelier before dining at an old canal side inn. Finally, mooring up at the medieval town of Capistan.
But first, we're after something a little more in-depth than your average canal guide. So we're heading to a rather special local bookshop.
Lamartine, Daudet, Balzac.
Dickens, Shakespeare?
No Shakespeare, no.
N'existe pas.
Dickens, no, quite.
They might not be so hot on English literature, but we've certainly come to the right place. It's enormous.
Bonjour.
Bonjour, bonjour, madame.
Nous cherchons quelque chose sur les canaux du Midi.
Sur le canal du Midi, oui. Vous me suivez?
Merci.
Je vais vous montrer ce que j'ai.
Now, that's what I call a guidebook.
Voilà, et c'est le livre le plus important qui ait été écrit sur le canal du Midi. Hein.
It's the most important book ever written on the canal du Midi, yes.
Voilà.
Excellent. Yes, isn't that wonderful?
Oh, look.
Just what I'm looking for, a book published in the early 18th century, not long after the canal was built.
It's a wonderful book, and I would love to have it.
Quel est le prix de ce...
4,000 euros.
4,000, 4,000.
Yeah.
Just a little out of my price range.
It's probably for the best, Timmy.
Supposing you spilt something on it? Fortunately, there are over 50,000 books in this treasure trove, and we find what we're looking for at a price we can afford.
Originally built for trade, the Canal du Midi also opened up the Longue Dock to early tourism.
And one of our purchases is an account of a canal journey made in 1786 by an English lady, Anna Craddock, who stayed in this very hotel.
The 5th of May, 1785, Hotel de la Croix Blanche. The first remark of Mrs. Craddock was to note that the servants had bare feet and only the hostess wore shoes. If the food was well served, the lodging was perhaps rather uncivilized. At least, this was the opinion of Madame Craddock, who had to share her room with a maid and the chickens.
Yeah. It looks all right now, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah, rather charming. Come on, you want to get going.
Right.
The next morning, Anna Craddock continued her voyage aboard a barge pulled by horses.
Over two centuries later, aboard our diesel-powered vessel, we're following the same route.
Take over?
Yes.
All right.
As crew, I'm usually busy with the locks. There are very few on the Canal du Midi, which means for a change, I can take a turn at the helm.
Going here, and then correct it, otherwise it'll just go on.
All right.
Concrete wall, which is not a good idea.
What?
No.
Unbelievable. I don't understand. I'm sorry.
I think perhaps this isn't a good idea.
I can steer, but this boat's got a mind of its own.
Oh, Timmy.
It's coming. And as soon as it comes, then go back.
Right, okay.
That's better. Good.
Prue's got the hang of it now. And I can read from another of the books that we picked up at Le Somail.
Another visitor to the canal was Thomas Jefferson.
Oh, right.
He came here before he was president.
The United States ambassador at the time, Jefferson was touring the Midi in the summer of 1787 and having rather a good time of it.
The boat advances at a slow pace and rhythm, being hauled, presumably by hand. More often, I walk along the towpath, stimulated by the song of the nightingales in the shade of the double row of trees. The weather is also favorable. The journey continues under cloudless skies and crystal clear waters. Oh, the sun of the Midi, there is no substitute. If I happen to die in Paris, may my body be sent here to be exposed to its rays.
Ah,
lovely.
I didn't even know he ever came here, did you?
No.
Very touching.
Since Jefferson's voyage, the canal itself has altered very little. But the people who live along it have changed, as back in the 18th century, many of them didn't speak French.
Look, there they are.
Meeting us at the next bridge are Christian and Robert Sales, father and son musicians, whose passion is for the language and traditional songs that were once spoken and sung along this canal.
Bonjour. Merci beaucoup. Thank you very much.
They don't sing in French, but in Occitan.
During the construction of the canal, Riquet spoke Occitan with all the worker. Occitan is the language of the canal.
Pourrions nous entendre quelques...
Il veut que parle Occitan un petit peu.
Ah,
mais... Il
y avait la chance de naviguer sur un bel canal. Là, il vigne sud en caro verdos. Les aures nous parlent en passant. Quel plaisir de naviguer sur le canal.
Le canal des Riquettes.
It is very, very like a form of Italian, isn't it?
I like Italian.
And Spanish, too, also.
Yeah. When we speak Occitan, yes. It's totally compatible with Catalan.
Totally compatible,
same.
The language of Occitan was suppressed from the 16th century onwards and was gradually replaced by French. But in the Middle Ages, it was spoken not only in the Longue Dock, but throughout southern France.
If you want, we can sing for you a second, a traditional song.
Please.
Okay.
Occitan troubadours were famous throughout the medieval courts of Europe for their poetry and songs about love.
This is a traditional song.
It's a traditional song.
Yes.
It's a love song.
Yes.
Love song from Middle Ages.
The word amour, it's Occitan word amour.
Is it?
Yes.
Amour. Just ma finestro, ya
Yes, well.
Thank you.
Hauling barges through the heat of southern France was tiring work, and teams of horses were changed at relay stations along the canal. Crew and passengers were also fed.
You can't change your horses at the Auberge de la Croisade anymore, but you can still get a fine canal-side supper.
Bonjour.
Bonjour, bonjour.
Et merci.
Soyez les bienvenus. Bonjour, enchanté. Bonjour, monsieur.
Bruno, the proprietor, and his chef, Laurent, are inspired by the traditional food of this region and are going to serve us a meal the canal travellers would have eaten at relay stations like this in the 18th century.
Madame Craddock.
Yeah.
Hôtel de la Croix Blanche, 1785. Puree of lentil soup, warm pâté with garnish, fried brains, two lamb chops, three lapwings, two dozen oysters, bread, wine, fruits, coffee and liqueur.
That must have cheered her up a bit. Such a bad time,
it's a big menu.
I don't want to eat lapwings. I think it's cruel.
Maybe you can come in the kitchen to give a hand to the chef.
Yes, of course.
For the recipe, yeah?
Ah.
Aujourd'hui, on va cuisiner des vieux menus qui existaient à l'époque, avant, voilà.
I'll be helping Laurent prepare dishes eaten by the passengers and ones eaten by the crew.
Ça c'est les lamb chop and the brain.
Excellent.
Ah, j'ai préparé une sauce tomate.
I've never been able to get my head round snails. I mean, well, if I'm my tongue round snails. I've never heard of them in tomato sauce.
Ah, fried brains in batter. Never had that before either.
Fascinating.
This is one dish I do know how to cook.
Et voilà. Les escargots que vous allez goûter maintenant.
The moment I've been dreading, Laurent is insisting I try one of the snails.
Bon appétit. Alors ça va?
Ce n'est pas le goût,
c'est la texture.
I don't know, the texture is such an enemy to me. I can't sort of think about the taste.
It's time to serve Tim a dish eaten by canal workers 250 years ago, cervelle d'agneau, lamb's brain fritters.
Wonderful.
Vous l'avez cuisiné, vous allez le goûter.
Merci.
Very delicate, isn't it? It's beautiful.
No. Not for me.
Not for you?
No, I don't like.
You don't like the idea of it?
No. So the workers had the lamb's brains and the bosses had the chops.
Of course. Yes. The best piece.
Dominated by the impressive church of Saint-Étienne, Capistan is a popular mooring spot, and we've headed into town this morning for a café au lait.
Merci.
This visit to France has brought back memories of an amour de jeunesse, when I was young and in love with Bernard, a writer and academic.
So, what would it have been like to be married to, who was a French-Japanese demonologist?
Yes.
I mean, he quite fancied you, obviously.
Bernard.
Yeah.
We were in love, actually. Yeah.
Do you miss it? A life of Franco-Japanese demonology?
No, hardly at all, darling. Really, I don't think I miss it at all. I've had very few regrets, if any. Done awfully well. Well, I do think I made the right decision.
You still believe that?
Yes. Yes.
Well, that's.
Well, it will be.
That's
terrible.
Good to hear.
It'd be terrible to change one's mind at this stage, wouldn't it? Because there's nothing much one can do about it.
As it's a little late to change your husband now, we may as well continue our journey.
Every love in life is important from the first to the last. As they say in France, il n'y a qu'un bonheur dans la vie, c'est d'aimer et d'être aimé. There is only one happiness in life, to love and be loved.
Leaving Capistan, we'll pass the village of Poil before travelling through the world's first canal tunnel. Descending Fonceran locks, we'll visit the town of Béziers before our final night on the canal at Port-Iragne.
These beautiful plane trees, I mean, they're really the trademark of the Canal du Midi, aren't they? Plane trees on either side of the canal.
Plane trees have been a feature of the Canal du Midi since the 17th century. Aside from their natural elegance, they were planted to strengthen the banks and give boaters some shade from the fierce Midi sun. But now they're under threat.
There's a disease attacking all the plane trees, and alas, a lot of them are being systematically cut down and will have to be burnt.
The canker was introduced in the war with American GIs whose ammunition boxes were made of infected wood. The microscopic fungus gradually spread its way up from the coast. Of the 42,000 trees along the canal, to date, the authorities have felled over 7,500 in a desperate bid to stop the spread.
You may have noticed white crosses on some of the trees. They're ones that are being condemned. So there's a cross there. These are all crosses. They've all got to go. Very sad.
So sad to see them cut down, to think they're in some way doomed.
Am I hearing that or imagining it?
It's amazing. Yeah, the bagpipes on a French canal.
Bravo! Excellent. Thank you.
Canals, always full of surprises.
Quite extraordinary.
As we continue towards Béziers, the canal meanders its way through the countryside of the Languedoc. Riquet designed his canal to follow the contours of the land, to keep it at the same level. But then he came to an obstacle too large to circumvent, the hill d'Anserune. His solution had never been attempted before, anywhere in the world.
We're just about to come to the Malpass Tunnel, which is the oldest canal tunnel in the world.
I didn't know about that.
Ah. And so everybody thought, why does he want to build a tunnel? A tunnel with water? I think it's a very bad idea.
Riquet's enemies saw this as his folie de grandeur and set about persuading Louis XIV's ministers that he was out of control and should be stopped. But Riquet wasn't beaten yet.
Hello! Hello, Philippe.
We're meeting local historian Philippe Callat.
Welcome.
Let's
go. You come with me?
To find out why Riquet refused to give up, Philippe is taking us 50 metres above the canal.
Incredible.
In the Middle Ages, this bowl was a giant mosquito-infested lake. but it was emptied by Franciscan monks, who dug a drainage tunnel through the hill d'Anserune.
This lake inspired Riquet to dig the canal, the tunnel of the Canal du Midi through the mountain of Malpas.
Riquet thought, if the monks can build a small tunnel in the 10th century, why can't I, in the 17th, build one big enough for a boat? But there was a problem. The king's ministers had called a halt to Riquet's excavations. Fortunately, the workers were on his side. And under the cover of darkness, they secretly began to dig the world's first navigable tunnel.
People said, what do you mean a canal tunnel? There's never been such a thing. How can there possibly be such a thing? And he did.
But here we are, 340 years later.
What an achievement.
Yes. Yeah. Brilliant.
First one ever.
Thanks to Riquet's skill and determination, we can head on towards the town of Béziers, nestled in the valley of the River Ob.
But to enter the town, we'll first have to descend the Fonsorin locks. Leonardo da Vinci invented the lock, but with this flight of eight, it was Riquet who transformed his design into a work of art. Beautiful as they are, I'm a little daunted. Steering through here in a hard-to-handle boat is not going to be easy. We'll both need to be on top form, especially as the locks are going to be crowded.
We're all waiting for the green light to go through the flight of locks, and there's an enormous queue of boats behind us, but we're first in.
We're known for our queuing in Britain, but I'm not so sure that it's a French tradition.
The gates are opening. And as I suspected, someone wants to get into the lock before us. Madam Lockkeeper is having none of it, but we'd better get in there quickly.
Through the other side.
Whoops.
Over there, please. Give them.
I'm concerned with other boats coming up behind us. We mustn't drift around in this lock.
Through other side.
Yes, all right, all right. I heard you.
I've been in dangerous locks before, but this one has got to be near the top of the list.
Do you want me to tie up or anything?
Yes, please. Just one tie up. Just pass it round and take it.
What?
Pass it round and take it.
I can't.
Throw it round.
I'm anxious, and it's making me rather titchy.
Just hold on tight.
After 40 years of operating locks myself, I'm finding these automated gates confusing.
Wait till the gates are open, then cast off. Wait till the gates are open, and then cast off.
It doesn't help that I forgot to put my hearing aids in this morning. I can't hear what the skipper says, but I do know he's getting cross.
Sorry, heat of the moment.
Look out, Timmy, you're going to hit me. Staircase of locks.
Fortunately, after a couple of locks, we start to get the hang of it. We're through. And now it's a straight run to Béziers across the Orb Aqueduct. This 19th century canal upgrade is the longest aqueduct on the Midi.
It's quite a considerable piece of engineering, I think. Castle over there, very impressive. And this very wide river below us. River Orb. It's a very impressive way to enter a town from above.
Archaeologists consider Béziers to be the oldest town in France. Important in the wine trade for over 2,000 years, it was exporting wine to Italy at the time of the Roman Empire.
It's past noon by the time we make it into town, and the Midi sun is beating down.
I'd like to leap into that now.
Yes.
I'm getting to like this here very much.
Yes, yes. Lovely. Look. Wonderful.
Whilst Pru enjoys the flower market, I'm going to explore, once I've bought a little snack.
Voilà. Tu dois faire à peu près. Voilà, il y a 1,1 kg. Merci.
Ticket, good.
Comment s'appelle ça?
L'amaranta.
Amaranta. Merci infiniment.
Avec plaisir.
Au revoir.
Béziers is not just another charming provincial town. It's the hometown of the engineering genius behind the Canal du Midi. And here is Pierre Paul Riquet.
The great man?
Ah, oui! Pierre Paul Riquet, ordinateur.
This was his birthplace.
Ah. Yeah.
So what have you got?
Well, some flowers for me.
Very colourful.
Yes. Yeah.
I've got some oysters.
Okay, good.
The town seems rather jolly on this sunny summer's afternoon, but there is a terrible event from Béziers' history that echoes down the centuries.
Well, this is the cathedral, the site of the massacre of the Cathars in 1209. Every single person was killed, even those that had taken refuge in the cathedral.
The Cathar cult was a mixing of Christianity and Middle Eastern philosophies. Seen as a direct threat to the Catholic Church, Pope Innocent III called for a crusade to crush the Cathars. This holy war reached its terrible climax when crusading knights sacked the Cathar stronghold of Béziers. Both Cathars and local Christians sought refuge in the town's churches and cathedral, but to no avail. The crusaders either cut them down or burnt them alive. In all, 20,000 died that day in Béziers, men, women, and children.
Nobody survived at all. Grisly times.
It may have been centuries ago, but this beautiful scene, the elegant cathedral perched above the lush river valley, it still seems somehow tinged with sadness. Back on the canal, and evening is drawing in.
Oh, moon. It'll be full in a couple of nights' time.
Yes.
We've reached the outskirts of Portiragne and our overnight mooring.
All right. There's some blotting paper. Oh.
Well, it's not a bad spot, is it?
Tomorrow, we'll have a full family crew for our final push down to the Mediterranean Sea.
It's our final day on Riquet's masterpiece. His dream was to create a canal entre deux mers, to link the Atlantic with the Mediterranean. And today we'll see the fulfillment of that dream as we reach the southern coast of France.
To help us get there, we've enlisted extra crew.
Bienvenue! Whoa.
In the shape of our son Joe and his two sons, Clem and Felix.
Travelling from Portiragne, we'll head for the unusual three-way lock at Island. From there, it's only a few miles to the old port of Les Anglous, where the canal meets the gateway to the Med at the Etang du Tau. With Joe living in France, we need to take every opportunity to be together. Especially as Prue's condition is not going to get any better.
How does she seem to?
Now?
Yeah.
Just a bit more forgetful. You know, things that used to be fairly familiar. She can't find things in the kitchen. Can never find her handbag.
No, well, that's...
And loses things like her hearing aids with alarming regularity.
Well, she's got a butterfly mind. I think that hasn't changed.
That hasn't changed.
But it's when you jump off to one thing and then you can't remember where you just jumped off from.
Yes, I think what she's really hot on is her early life, drama school, and what relationships she had and what relationships she wished she'd had.
Yes.
That's all very, very clear.
Yes. She does remember stuff that is from that life before being the grown-up that she became.
Yes, that's before she married me.
Well, that's obviously where it all went wrong.
That's clearly where it all went wrong.
The Frenchman I nearly married, his speciality was Japanese demonology of the 11th century.
That's very specific, especially for a Frenchman.
He was a fascinating man, and we were very in love. Have I not told you this story?
No,
on top of the tower at Notre Dame and talking about whether we were going to marry, and I would come out with him to Japan. And suddenly a voice said, "Oh, Mummy, it can't be much higher." And around the corner came two girls who lived quite near my parents in darkest Surrey. And I suddenly thought, oh, bugger, I can't marry a Frenchman.
Well, it's lucky you didn't, so.
Why?
Because if you didn't, I wouldn't be there right now.
Oh, yeah.
Either that or I'd be speaking Japanese.
Tim is and always will be the man for me. But looking back, non, je ne regrette rien. I think we're so lucky. I grew up with this very strong kind of feeling for France, and the fact that Joe married my darling daughter-in-law, and you and your siblings, has been a really great treat, a great reward.
Well, cheers.
As we near the sea, this low-lying land becomes a series of muddy flats and shallow lakes, a haven for birds, but a problem for canal engineers, which was solved here in a most unusual way.
I think this may be the beginning of the ouvrage.
Crumbs, is that it?
Yeah, I think so.
At this point, the canal is crossed by the river Libron. Prone to flash floods, it can easily silt up the canal. Engineers would normally solve this problem by building an aqueduct, taking the canal over the river. But that's not possible here, as both are on exactly the same level.
Oh la la!
It wasn't until 174 years after the canal was finished that French engineers finally came up with a solution. A complex series of sluices that send the canal and the Libron through separate channels when the river is in flood.
So they bring the two channels together,
yes,
and then they open the sluices, and then the river can run through it without depositing its silt in.
Yes, and you close the canal.
Yeah. And you close the canal while it's happening. So it's kind of like a level crossing for two
rivers. It is like a level crossing, yes. It's complicated. It has echoes of Heath Robinson, but as a partly French family, I have to concede that the French did have some very good engineers too.
Needs to rain heavily before the ouvrage is put to use. Today, the river sluices are all closed, allowing us to glide through.
The ancient town of Agde was founded by the Phoenicians over 2,500 years ago. In the 17th and 18th centuries, the canal made this a prosperous place. Today, it's clear that this stretch has seen better times. Fortunately, the lock is well maintained.
So here we are, Enrique's round lock. To the right, the river into the town of Agde, and we are going straight on.
We're nearing the end of our journey, and this is the last stretch of the canal before the Mediterranean Sea.
This is the completion of his route from one sea to another, and it would be nice to feel that the Hotel Riquet, which we've just passed, was still open for voyagers like ourselves. But alas, no, the property boom has not hit Agde yet.
The canal leads us down to the Etang de Thau, a saltwater lake that links directly to the sea. At the old canal port of Anglou, canal barges would transship their goods onto larger vessels that would then head out into the Mediterranean and beyond. But that's all gone now. In its place, a sailing school.
Hello.
Hello.
Paul.
Hello.
Oh. This is very kind of you.
Elle est un peu dure parfois, c'est normal.
Paul, one of the school skippers, is going to take us on the last leg of our journey.
Essayez de synchroniser. Voilà, c'est bon.
We're under sail. So, where are we exactly?
Here we are at the end of the Canal du Midi, on the Etang de Thau.
And on your right side, behind this sandbank, we have the Mediterranean Sea.
So this is the end of Riquet's great design, all the way from Toulouse to the Etain and out into the Mediterranean. Great achievement, and a wonderful way to finish it, isn't it?
Yes, magic.
Riquet allowed nothing to dim his passion, even his own advancing years.
Riquet was actually 59, I think, when he began the work on the canal.
Well, I sympathize. I just want to go on working until the day I drop, and I think he's a wonderful example, actually. Life can begin at 50.
Or beyond.
Or beyond.
Riquet's grand ambition was to link two oceans, but today he simply united two branches of one family, English and French.
Well, here's a toast to Anglo-French relations.
À la France!
L'entente cordiale.
L'entente cordiale, oui.
Next week, a voyage across Scotland from coast to coast.
Long canals that have been totally transformed.
Look at them. Aren't they amazing?
Giving us a glimpse into the future of Britain's waterways.
Very exciting. I'm a bit scared.